has come to our family. You remember our venerable house? Opulent and imperial, gazing proudly from its stoic perch above the moor. I lived all my years in that ancient, rumor-shadowed manor, fattened by decadence and luxury. And yet I began to tire of conventional extravagance. Singular, unsettling tales suggested the mansion itself was a gateway to some fabulous and unnameable power. With relic and ritual, I bent every effort towards the excavation and recovery of those long-buried secrets, exhausting what remained of our family fortune on swarthy workmen and sturdy shovels. At last, in the salt-soaked crags beneath the lowest foundations, we unearthed that damnable portal of antediluvian evil. Our every step unsettled the ancient earth. But we were in a realm of death and madness. In the end, I alone fled laughing and wailing through those blackened arcades of antiquity. Until consciousness failed me. You remember our venerable house? Opulent and imperial. It is a festering abomination. I beg you, return home, claim your birthright, and deliver our family from the ravenous, clutching shadows of the darkest dungeon.
Darkest Dungeon is about making the best of a, or rather the most of a bad situation. Quests will fail or must be abandoned, heroes will die, and when they die, they stay dead. And the progress autosaves constantly. It expects a lot, and has a lot to give. Welcome everyone, for I am Super Blue Badger and this is Darkest Dungeon. A game that I have been quite enthralled with of late. Developed by Red Hook Studios, the game went through an early access period, and actually fully released it. And if that isn't a fucking trophy in 2016, then I don't really know what is. For those watching, we'll be playing build 13887, as seen in the top left there. And let me tell you why you should give a damn about this game. The game has drawn a lot of inspiration from stories about combat stress, and as such, this has become a core mechanic of the game. Throughout the stages, we will be afflicted with an onslaught of diseases, injuries, and afflictions against your crowd of lemmings that you have at your disposal. These will have quite the effect on our soldiers, for it will potentially drive them to madness, should permadeath not reach them first. To let you know, this is a challenge run. No light. I'll explain what that really entails and what that means as we enter the tutorial stage of the game, because it's a bit too much to describe now. On top of this, characters can be renamed. Should you leave quite a good comment in the section, in the section below, then I will perhaps add your YouTube name to one of the characters. Please keep in mind that a few episodes are recorded in advance, so it may be a few episodes before you appear. Other than that, shall we get started? We click the ladder to begin, and name our mansion. The Dankest Battalion. Why? For some reason, my muscle memory always writes darkest as dankest. Must be all my years as a filthy memer. But without further ado, let us continue.
You will arrive along the old road. It winds with a troubling, serpent-like suggestion through the corrupted countryside, leading only, I fear, to ever more tenebrous places. There is a sickness in the ancient, pitted cobbles of the old road. And on its writhing path, you will face viciousness, violence, and perhaps other damnably transcendent terrors. So steel yourself, and remember there can be no bravery without madness. The old road will take you to hell, but in that gaping abyss, we will find our redemption.
The soldiers arise from their overturned carts. Days lifting from their eyes, the world slowly coming into view. The two soldiers look around and find themselves in unfamiliar territory. But for the time being, we will take a moment to understand the complexities of Darkest Dungeon. Here is our stat sheet. We have one of the most important functions of the game here. We have negative quirks and positive quirks. Positive quirks includes plus 10% damage if the torch is above a certain level of light. Negative quirks include God-fearing. In town, you will only pray for stress relief, and kleptomaniac, where you are prone to stealing items. These can dearly affect the usefulness of your individual soldiers, and we'll get a bit more into it as time goes on, but I'm sure you can understand how this works. Kleptomaniac is a right pain in the dick. As you come across various loot chests, he will essentially take them for himself and give none to the party, i.e. you. It can be a massive pain, and you want to be rid of it as soon as possible. Draw your attention to the right, preferred position, and preferred target. Normally, we will be granted 4 party members. In this occasion, we only have the 2. Has both a preferred position of the first and second slot, and with the enemies, would prefer hitting the enemies of the first and second slot again. As you can see, as we hover over the tooltips, it gives us the selection of where you need to be to use it, and alternatively, who you can hit while you are in that location. It gives us information such as accuracy, or bonuses such as damage to the unholy. If there is a line drawn between 2 targets, that means it will strike both of them. Obviously, this comes with a hefty damage modifier of 40%. Some not so inclined to damage is Stunning Blow. As you can imagine, this stuns people. Great, you want to make them lose a turn? Best way to do it. Bulwark of Faith increases protection and also marks targets, so by marking himself makes him more inclined to be attacked by the enemy, with specific attacks, not necessarily all attacks. These camping skills, irrelevant. We won't be getting into these yet because they are only involved in medium and long dungeon runs. We also have our various resistances, not really that important to you, the viewer, and our regular stats. For instance, Dismas here is a known cheat, not allowed to gamble, but he has Hard Noggin, which allows him to be resistant to stuns, and Quick Reflexes, allowing him to go first in a party. Which is, well, not first, but more likely to go first. Another alternative choice I would like to mention is that you can actually rename your soldiers. So we will be renaming this one Stan of Stone. And our companion will be known as Dolan. Wonderful. These two powerful adventurers set out into the forest. But not before Badger interrupts with another explanation. You wish to move on, you say? Well, this is a no light run. As you can see right now, we have 100 light, radiant light, which gives us a bonus to scouting and monster surprise. Surprised, rather. And with that, that just makes the game all too easy, but with a shift, control, and a click.
The darkness holds much worse than mere trickery and boogeyman.
Darkness sets in. Our adventurers are filled with a sense of unease. With a plus 4 to stress, plus 3 to monster accuracy and damage, and plus 3 to hero surprised. But alternatively, loot is increased, and our crits are increased. It's a quick way to die, but a very quick way to get rich easy.
Brigands have run. these lanes. Keep to the side path. The hamlet is just ahead.
And so we proceed, unknowing of the dangers that come lurk ahead. As a cutthroat blocks our path, brandishing dual blades. Dolan raises his knife and strikes at his throat. A gush of blood just spatters across his armor as he retaliates with an uppercut slice, driving Stan of Stone to the back. He regains his footing, brandishing his claymore. There is a certain refusal of death. He draws the blade down upon the cutthroat, annihilating him from this world. And 300 gold coins for our coffers. Not bad, but we could do better. Occasionally, you will find objects in the corridors and backgrounds. This tent could provide us anything. A map, money. And in this occasion,
finding the stuff
money.
Is only the first test. Now it must be carried home.
There is also food in our bars.
There is much to be found in forgotten places.
Let me speak, please. Food allows us to stave off hunger. You will need this as your party ventures through. But it's also, if you have a little bit lying around, feel free to snack on it. Heals you for 2 health a pop, but you can only have 4 of them at a time.
An ambush. Send these vermin a message.
Our party is surprised at the oncoming ambush. They bust out from behind the trees, brandishing their flails and guns. Our adventurers, already dazed from the venture here, weary with their stamina weakened, did not know how to act in this situation. But Dolan does not let this take the better of him. No, he brandishes his knife and strikes for the bloodletter, drawing blood from his veins. As pellets spray upon him and Stan of Stone, plinking from their armor, driving them back. In a futile attempt to buy them some time, he strikes a stunning blow to the bloodletter, trying to leave him stunned despite his high resistance with his hearty attitude. And with that, we've mitigated some damage. As we drive the blade into his chest again, blood spatters across the land. As the rain of pellets strikes us once more. Stan regains his footing and drives the claymore down onto the shoulder of this bloodletter.
Prodigious size alone does not.
And his loss of blood drops him to the ground. The fusilier is driven back as he quickly tries a rush shot, digging into his chest, but it's fine. Dolan stands tall. He sees victory is near. As Stan pushes Dolan out of the way, seeking victory, decapitating the fusilier.
Maintain the offensive.
His head rolls across the forest into the background and into the darkness. Victory is theirs, and the hamlet is just down the road. They've finally made it. They are granted gems, baubles, cash, and a portrait. And our quest is complete. Which grants us respite to count the coins in our coffers. 5,000 gold was a quest reward. 1,675 was what we found, along with a citrine. The portraits are heirlooms, and we'll get into that in just one moment. At the end of a quest, we have a chance of receiving a quirk, both those positive and negative, along with our experience points. On this occasion, we're given the healer's gift, 20% to heal skills while camping. Could be beneficial, but I'm not quite sure. I'm not sure whether that refers to his heal skills or whether it's him being healed. And so we return to the hamlet.
Welcome home, such as it is. This squalid hamlet, these corrupted lands, they are yours now, and you are bound to them.
As they approach the place of solace, what is meant to be their home for the remainder of the game, they look upwards into the night sky and see nothing but decrepit, shitty old buildings. Dolan and Stan look to each other as if... wondering why they came here in the first place. Past the chapel, they see the foregone mansion, filled with an eldritch horror, some unspoken evil. We're granted access to only a few facilities at this point, and we'll go over them as they unlock. The graveyard is where we may view our fallen heroes, but pointless for the time being, for no one has actually died. The Ancestor's Memoirs are where we view the story of the game, but there is nothing to really view other than the opening cutscene. The Stagecoach, however, is most definitely the important place to go, for the remainder of our initial party will be there.
Women and men, soldiers and outlaws, fools and corpses. All will find their way to us now that the road is clear.
We are granted a plague doctor, a person that is, well, a lady underneath the mask. They are able to throw noxious gases, toxic acid, and also support their party by curing in tow. They also are allowed to buff their party with damage and speed. A very good member for the third position, with quick draw, extra speed on the first round, and extra damage to range skills. However, they have a bit of a interest in the if you know what I mean, wink wink. You know, we'll leave that as it is for now. And here we have the Vestal, or what you might call a cleric. They have various skills granted onto them by God. Healing spells, light, illumination, and damage against the unholy. But in most occasions, you will not be using them for anything more than healing. They have quite a bad quirk. Stress Eater, plus 100% food consumed if stress is above 50. Diabolical. This will eat into our party and cause much trouble in the future. For food, you can only carry so much of. We need to be rid of that, and soon. However, they receive minus stress damage and extra scouting chance in the ruins and warrens respectively. This could prove very beneficial. For the time being, how about we rearrange their names? We will name you Twangafar.
What better laboratory than the blood-soaked battlefield?
And our Vestal shall be named Guten Gregai.
A sister of battle, pious and unrelenting.
And with that, we're granted a full party to make our first official foray into the ruins, to see what treasures and dangers lurk for us. The newly found party look to each other in unease. So far, the introduction hasn't been most welcoming, and they don't expect the next chapter to be any more so. They sharpen their blades, load their pistols, and discuss tactics for what comes next, for this ragtag band of ne'er-do-wells seeking fame and fortune. They have no idea what to expect, and whether their sanity will last in such a place. See you next time for Darkest Dungeon, Episode 2.